Good afternoon and welcome back to the Telling the Stories of Jesus as a Strategy for Social Justice and Peacemaking in the Global Community with Tom Boomershine and the network of Biblical Storytellers and the Center and Library for the Bible and Social Justice. We're transitioning between meeting spaces and running just a little bit behind a smooth transition here for this session. So we'll be gathering momentarily and begin. This session has some video segments that will be shown from an Apple computer. And so it's another test of this system to see if they are captured effectively in the course of the conversation at the table. And we'll turn off some of the overhead lights and move into that. But we're just about to begin, and I'll turn this around and bring the audience into view momentarily. Okay, well then he needs to come around.
Shall we wait or shall we start?
I think it's up to you. I think we ought to have everybody at the table to begin. And my understanding is eventually we can re-edit these. I'm afraid if I stop it, I'm not sure I can start.
Right. Oh, I got two. You choose yellow or white.
Three. Depending on your mood.
Right. Okay. It's a long while ago, by the way. Some claim that there were Jewish followers of Jesus who fought in the war. I don't know where they were gathering that information, but it was kind of news to me. And I don't think it was the claim of the great majority, but I don't know. I don't know if you've gone across that.
I have not. I know of no evidence.
I don't even know how to get back to it. But I don't think it was Josephus. It's doubtful that he's referring to Christians at all. Some passages are maybe interpolated.
Okay. Theoretically
possible, but I don't know of any evidence.
There's a book that was written by Dominic Thompson and some other men. And in there, it talks about having two processions in Palm Sunday. One was a procession of Jesus, and the other one was a Roman procession. I haven't found the book to see exactly why I would say that. I thought that was really neat. There is that parallel between the Romans and the other. I just saw a small quote.
I don't know. You think it was Clausen?
It was Clausen from on with somebody else.
What was the book about? I don't know.
In relation to this text of Jesus of Mark, very distinguished. I don't know, in terms of the performance criticism, there's a large group of people who are a part of that. So the series that Rickenstock is publishing on performance criticism, Peter Botha, David Rhodes, John Dewey, James Maxey.
There's a
range of people who are part of that. This, there has not been an application of our performance criticism principles and methods to the study of performance scores. So this is really the first. And it has generated a radically different perspective on motion tracking. That has to do with the audience, it has to do with the setting, although a number of people agree, say the majority of the scholars, a great majority, agree that the composition of the gospel was in the context of the war, either during it or more intermediate accidents. I think that is so on that, there is a significant amount of support among a number of scholars. And so, Adelia Collins and Marcus agree on that as a setting, a historical setting. But in terms of this analysis of the meaning and impact of the gospel in its original context. At this point, if there are allies, they will be allies who engage data, change them up. So I don't know of anyone who has advocated that the audience or the non-religious beings were not
at some points and not only
direction. Yes.
I have the same thing that happened in the early years of indigenous is almost 95% argued today. And Mendenhall and I were among the first 20%. And in our social science working group, there was a lot of discussion, you know, back and forth about things that I made. And Mendenhall came to the first one, maybe two. But he soon dropped out because he was a very opinionated man. This is it. And your stuff is, my stuff is Marxist, but his stuff, basically the same with different labels, is not.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, great. He was a very rich participant, so he didn't.
Yeah. Well, what's happened in relation to this development is that the argument around the original character of Marx's performance literature, that was a new idea 25 years ago. So the Bible and ancient modern media has had a major impact in the field in regard to the widespread extension of that opinion and judgment about the character of modern and development. but in relation with the specifics. Another part of it is that I haven't gotten this out. Well, there hasn't been one that I've talked about it.
That's true. That's true.
And I've written a number of articles about audience addresses.
Yes.
But they've not been widely read. So we don't know yet. And I don't expect to live long enough to see this become a major.
So you can see the final proof of these next events.
This is really the last one that I sent. It's the next one. Which was the first. So, JC, and it will kind of
well, Douglas says he has a book that he needs to get out before he dies. So that kind of sounded like you talking.
Yeah.
On the, oh, I need,
I don't know why it would be in there because
I need to move
out.
Yeah, I'm going to let you do it. Well, I need to put this in.
Maybe you get
it in there. So I don't know. I think you can check for the library. Here's the
one that I was going to mess it up before I can move it up. I think they had to leave. I think they had to go back.
Yes, they did.
And then Jennifer had an appointment. She had to go back.
Well, then you're up there, see?
Yes, right back there. In the right turn left. So she's calling that up.
Maybe it was totally out of tone. Maybe it was
totally out of tone.
Some of them would be useful for me. Very celebrated names.
Well, I think it takes a little while, but I'm not sure how. I thought you charged it all up.
Well, I did, but we had it over here all day yesterday. I didn't charge it.
It wasn't being used.
Well, I don't.
It's a mystery.
It was left open the whole time.
I didn't
do it. Right now.
No way to turn it on.
Button.
I was intrigued by the way Katrina did the four parts this way.
Yeah.
And I began to think of various ways.
Yeah, sometimes people do, you know, totally.
And you can do this, make four panels this way.
Yeah, that's what I did. Yeah, and I only did that because I saw somebody else do that. Kind of nice.
Yeah, I
liked
it.
Plus, I had stuff. Okay, what do you want?
Maybe
you can see where we're at.
No, maybe then. He's just doing these two. You didn't do that.
Yes.
Yeah, so discover the
So for those who
have been waiting,
we will start at 3:34 on the, so it'll be 20 minutes in. And if we're editing out those first minutes, it'll be 20 minutes out.
Right.
But why don't I go ahead and do the introduction again, just so we have it right up ahead here. So, welcome back to the series of live streams of telling the stories of Jesus as a strategy of social justice and peacemaking in the global community, with Tom Boomershine of the Network of Biblical Storytellers and gotell.org and the Center and Library for the Bible and Social Justice, a series of discussions and workshops, a seminar on storytelling and social justice held at the Community of Living Traditions, the Stony Point Center, during the weekend of May 29th to 31st, 2010. This is the third session on the myth of redemptive violence and the gospel of redemptive nonviolence. So, Tom, welcome back.
Thank you. We're working this afternoon on Pilate 5, and which is the central story of Jesus' passion, and we've been learning that story and identifying the questions and issues that arise from our initial encounter with that story. And what I want to do is to work through a brief performance criticism study, analysis of that story, to provide a context then for us to address the underlying issue, which is the choice of Barabbas rather than Jesus, and the prevalence of the myth of redemptive violence in the ancient world and in the modern world. My file here, where is it? I'm looking for my file that has the Aeneid and the, and maybe in my folder, which is right up there, right there. Okay, so Pilate trial and its context. That's it. Jesus is handed over to Pilate, and that is the fulfillment of Jesus' prophecy, that he would be handed over to the chief priests, the scribes, that they would condemn him to death, and they would hand him over to the Gentiles. So the phrase that is used is then that the fulfillment of the prophecy is that he is handed over to not the Gentiles, but to Pilate, the representative of the Gentiles and of the Roman Empire. So Mark replaces the Gentiles with Pilate. And the immediate implication of that fulfillment is that the rest of the prophecy will be fulfilled, which is they will mock him, spit upon him, flog him, and kill him. So the prophecy is that that's how the Son of Man will be treated by the Gentiles. And in this most detailed prophecy, the actions of the Gentiles are foreseen as much more violent than those of the Israelite religious authorities, which is that they would condemn him to death, but they will simply hand him over to the Gentiles in terms of the character of prophecy. Now, this allusion to the Gentiles generates the memories of the treatment of Israelites by Gentiles in previous trials. And the specifics of that are the most immediate is the trial of Eleazar and the seven boys before Antiochus the fourth Epiphanes, which is in 2 Maccabees 6 and 7. And the character of that story I'll just briefly summarize it. Antiochus the fourth Epiphanes was the ruler of the Antioch regime in Syria, and he announced that all observance of Jewish religious custom, of Israelite religious custom, was to be abolished. Anyone caught with copies of the scriptures was to be executed. Anyone caught observing the dietary laws was to be executed. The first show trial was of Eleazar, an old man, and he was required to either eat pork or be killed. The of the story is that he had friends who were part of Antiochus' group who appealed to him, "We'll give you other meat. And you could eat it and just pretend that it's pork." And that would be enough. And finally, Eleazar said, "Why would I pretend and lead young Israelites to think that I, an old man, have violated the traditions of Israel? I will not do that. Rather, it is better for me to die a noble death and to observe the customs and the laws of our people." So he is handed over and put on the rack and literally torn apart. Then there was a family of seven boys and their mother. And one by one, Antiochus gave them a choice: either eat pork or be killed. The oldest one defied Antiochus. And so he instructed that his tongue be cut out, that his hands be cut off, and that he be fried in a pan. And that was just the first. And so one after another, the seven brothers are all executed. So that is the background of the Jewish martyr tradition and of the stories of the trial of the at the hands of the Gentiles. So the tortures that Jesus predicts that he will suffer are of the same character as what happened under Antiochus the Fourth Epiphanes, who was a Syrian mass murderer. And so because of that, when Pilate then enters the story, given the prophecy and the memories that that evoked for people who knew the tradition of Israel, he is immediately characterized as an enemy, of the people of Israel. So his first question then is, "Are you the king of the Judeans?" Which I'm translating as the Judeans rather than the Jews, because of that being a later term that was used. But in this case, it is a term that is specifically used by Mark, only by people outside the tradition of Israel. So the Jews is only used by Mark, that is, for you dioi. I'm translating Judeans most of the time. is a term that is only used when Mark is describing the response and the character of the religion of Israel for outsiders, and or when he is describing their use of names. So it's only the Romans who use this name, Judaeo, to describe Jesus, which is itself indicative about the appeals of the story in relation to the Judean, the predominant Judean audience. The the indictment again that the chief priests bring against Jesus, which is the implication of this, is that Pilate is asking their question. That is, The implication of the story is that the chief priests came, they had a plan. But they accused him of claiming to be the king of the Jews, a term that Jesus never used. So Pilate asked, "Are you the king of the Judeans?" To which Jesus responds with a statement that is a classic instance of yes and no. It is a classic instance of a non-answer. You are saying, you say, the words in Greek are simply sou leges. You're saying it. It stands in marked contrast to the question that has just been asked by the chief priest. Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed? To which Jesus responds, I am. Pilate asks him, are you the king of the Judeans? You're saying. So Jesus knows how to respond positively or negatively. So in this instance, he is again perceived as one who is playing the trial game in a way that has the potential of working, that is, that he might be released. So the next part of the trial is then, Pilate asks him again, after the chief priests accused him of many things, have you no answer to me? You can see how many things they're charging him. But now Jesus was silent and said nothing. An important piece of information about ancient law is that silence was regarded as a legitimate defense. There was no requirement of testimony against yourself. There was no requirement of testimony, indeed, being silent in response to charges was a legitimate defense and was seen as and regarded by legal practice as an indication that you were not guilty. So there is an implication in Jesus' silence that in turn explains Pilate's final response to this interrogation. So that Pilate wondered. He was trying to figure what's going on here. Now, this characterization of Pilate has much the same structure as the characterization of Herod in the execution of John the Baptist. And so there is a precedent that provides a framework for the understanding of this trial. So in the case of Herod, he likes John the Baptist. He likes to listen, doesn't understand him, but you know, he liked to hear what he had to say and protected him from his wife, Herodias, who wanted to kill him and was plotting to kill him. But he protected him until, and this birthday party, when Herodias' daughter danced and he vowed, I'll give you whatever you want, even up to half of my kingdom. And so she went and asked him, no one knows that that's what they had done that. So now the king was in the dilemma. Didn't want to, but because of all of his guests, and wanting to keep his vow that he had made to the girl, rather, he sent a soldier who beheaded John and brought his head back. This is the way. This is the model of the autocrats. And so, in this case, what happens is that in this trial, of a prophet at the hands of Pilate, there is raised the possibility that Pilate wonders what's going on. And what happens then in the story is that the storyteller then explains a possibility of release, that Pilate would release any one prisoner whom they asked. Now, we have no historical evidence of this as a custom in regard to Roman procedure at the Jewish holiday. But the implication of the story is that Mark's audiences knew about this, would have found this perfectly normal and acceptable. Mark clearly assumes that. That is, he's not making it up. We don't have evidence of that, but that doesn't mean we have very little evidence of things from the ancient world. So we cannot conclude from the fact that we don't have evidence that it wasn't something that was practiced. And the next description is that there was a man in prison named Barabbas. And the phrase literally is translated, who was bound with the insurrectionists who had committed murder during the insurrection. Now the word stasis is the most frequent word that Josephus uses for the people of the revolution, or the warriors, or the armies of the Zealot revolt, of which there were several different factions. So the Zealots were only one of several factions led by various leaders. The Sicarii were another group. There were the followers of John of Giscala, who ended up being the dominant military figure in the leadership of the army. That was an earlier thing of the Egyptian who led out.
There would have been a string of insurgencies.
Yes, there were a
string. So we don't know exactly which one.
Well, what is clearly implied, we have no evidence of an insurgency at the time around Jesus, 33, 34. But what is, I think, clear about this is whatever it refers to historically, that Mark's listeners would have heard this as a reference to the insurgency, the war.
That was a big one.
Right. And uses the same terms to describe this. So the associations of this description in the Pilate trial are with the revolution, with the Judean and the war, as is the case also with the description of the temple as a den of lasers, a den of revolutionaries, insurgents. In Jesus' statement in the temple. So what is evoked for the listeners in relation to this identification of Barabbas and of those who had committed murder during the insurrection is the stream of insurrections that were present in the first century. But the major one was the Judean-Roman War. Now, the so Mark's use of the terms that Josephus employs for the various insurgent groups is not idiosyncratic. The descriptions of Barabbas are congruent with Josephus' usage, as are they are in the other Gospels. So Matthew describes Barabbas as Desmion Epissimon, which means a notorious prisoner. And Josephus usually uses this term, Epissimon, to describe distinguished, eminent, or honorable citizens, often victims of the insurgent forces. But in his initial description of John of Gisk, who was the most violent of the leaders in the insurrection, Josephus uses the word in exactly the sense that he uses it, that Matthew uses it, that is. He calls him the most unscrupulous and crafty of all who have ever gained notoriety. And epistemon is the word for notoriety in Josephus' description of John. Luke's description of Barabbas is, this was a man who had been put in prison for an insurrection that had taken place in the city and for murder. And the and once again, Josephus frequently uses these terms, which here are revolution or insurrection and murder, to describe the leaders of the revolt. And finally, John simply names Barabbas as Elastus. As Elastus, the same word that Mark uses for the den of Elastus. And is the word also that Mark uses to describe those who are crucified with Jesus. There were crucified with him two Elastus, one on his right, one on his left. So Mark is then using language that evokes the same terms in the same period that Josephus' composition was done. So the these terms were in the air in the post-war context because of the way in which they had been used to describe the various factions and people during the war. One of the most striking things about Josephus' account of the war, and especially of the siege, is the degree to which the leaders of the various armies killed other Judeans. Romans killed a lot. But prior to the final siege, there were hundreds of people who were killed. In some instances, because they tried to get out through the walls, if they were caught, they were immediately executed. There were battles between the various revolutionary forces. And one of them was led by a high priest, a chief priest, who tried to organize an army and was initially successful. But due to a big storm that gave cover for a division of Idumean soldiers to get through walls, they finally lost, all of them. So these battles between the various revolutionary forces were part of the insurgent movement and was one of the dynamics that was going on. Now the most important thing in the dynamic of Mark's story is the characterization of the crowd and the implication in this story that the crowd would ask for Jesus. So the climax of this episode of the description of Barabbas is coming up, the crowd began to ask, to demand, I think it's a better translation, that Pilate observe the custom. Well, this custom addressed the expectation that the crowd would ask for Jesus, because the crowd was the most positive character throughout the whole of the gospel in relation to Jesus. More so than the disciples, who don't understand, whatever. But the crowd is always positive about Jesus. That's both in Galilee, it's also in Jerusalem. Now you raised, Norman, whether we're talking about different crowds, and Ray Brown identifies that and says, he thinks clearly there's no relationship. That is, the people who were coming up at the Pilate trial were a different crowd than would have been present at the triumphal entry and certainly from Galilee. But in my opinion, that does not take seriously how stories work. That is, a character in a story like this is a character throughout. And that word evokes the associations that have been established earlier. And Mark regularly makes a distinction between the crowd and other crowds that are, for example, the crowd from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders armed with swords and clubs that arrests Jesus. So when he wants to describe another crowd, he uses additional terms to describe it. In this case, the coming up of the crowd is then to evoke the memories of the most consistent and positive supporter of Jesus throughout that history. And so, and that perception is confirmed by Pilate's response. He intuits that that's what they want. And offers, do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews, the king of the Judeans? So this is clearly then what the audience also would have concluded. That Pilate figures out, and Pilate's response is then a surprise. Why would Pilate do that? Well, because, and that's the question that Mark may answer. Well, the reason was that he perceived that it was out of jealousy, out of envy, that the chief priests, which is in turn for the listeners makes sense because of the character of the conflict between Jesus and the chief priests earlier in the story. So that Pilate perceived that and was skeptical about the high priest's motive, the chief priest's motive. You know, part of ancient politics. So what those guys did with each other and how they regarded each other. I won't take time to go through the characterization of the crowd, but it is, I'd recommend it to pay attention to that and to read through the gospel with that in mind, because that's the context in which Mark's listeners heard this story. They had just heard all these stories about Jesus' ministry in Galilee, about the response of the crowds there and in Jerusalem. So the great puzzle is then, what happened with the chief priests inciting the crowd to ask for Barabbas from the state, and of their clearly doom, which is only implied in the story, because Pilate's next question is, well, what then do you want me to do with one you call the Judean? So Mark does not report. So the crowd asked Pilate for Barabbas. We simply infer that from the character of Pilate's question. So the question raised by the story is, why? Why would the crowd change its mind? This is also where it is important to recognize that this is an example of the rhetoric of involvement rather than the rhetoric of condemnation. Because it is this story that is at the core of the tradition in Christian interpretation of this story, that the Jews killed Jesus. How did the Jews kill Jesus? Because they demanded his crucifixion. in the trial before Pilate. And the way in which this story has been understood is that it was told as a condemnation of the crowd, of the Jews. And in the Middle Ages, there are a number of stories about the passion narrative being read in churches and people going out after hearing this and attacking Jews because of what they had done to Jesus. But what is clear from the dynamics of this story is that that was not Mark's intention. That was not what this story meant. It was rather that it is like the story of the man and woman in the garden, the story of the people of Israel at Mount Sinai, of David, the David and Bathsheba story. That is, it is a story in which the listeners are invited to sympathetically identify with the character who then does something that is clearly, by the norms of the story, wrong. This is an instance, a primary instance, of that kind of rhetoric. That is, the crowd is a positive thing. The audiences are invited to identify. So that the choice, then, of Barabbas is a choice in which the audience is involved. And when you ask the question, what was the existential issue for Mark's audiences that would have given resonance to this question? The answer is the war. In the aftermath of the war, there is no ambiguity about the choice. We chose the revolutionary. So its symbolic significance and impact is then not they killed Jesus, but rather we were involved. So that the dynamic of this story is not accusation, but rather confession. And that's why it's so important how this story is told, how it's read. Often, the story is told, Pilate asks, well, what then do you want me to do with the one you call King of the Jews? And they shouted, crucify him. Pilate said, well, what crime has he committed? But they shouted all the more, crucify him. It all has to do with narrative attitude and the way in which the story is told. So if then this is a story of implication, of involvement of the audience in understanding and identifying and recognizing our involvement in this decision. The way in which the story was told is that the chief priests were able to incite the crowd to ask for Barabbas. It's incredible. And when then it is reported, Pilate asks, what then do you want me to do with the one you call King of the Jews? My description of this as a storyteller is one of horror and recognizing what it is that we have done. So it is the crowd that shouted, I don't believe it. Crucify. So that the way in which this story is interpreted by a storyteller makes all the difference in relation to its meaning and of its being heard in the context of the telling of the whole story of Mark's gospel and the characterization of the crowd. So the stories that were told this morning, that Laura and Norman told, are examples of precisely this kind of subtlety of storytelling. And the way in which these stories that have the rhetoric of what I'm calling involvement or implication can easily be flipped into the rhetoric of condemnation, which is what has happened with the story of man and the woman in the garden. Is the most graphic instance of that. The same storytelling interpreted reversal of meaning. To just take a story and exactly reverse its meaning. In the case of the man and the woman in the garden, to take the joke, oh, the woman you gave me, she's the one who's responsible, and turn it into a theological doctrine. So also with this story, take a story that is structured to involve the audience in the recognition of our involvement in the choice of Barabbas and of the insurrection, and turn it into an accusation that Jesus killed Jesus and generate this tradition of Christian conservatism. So, a basic principle I would like to emphasize is that this story needs to be heard and told rather than read and adopted. When it is read as a source of referential information rather than as a source for a storytelling experience, it is easy for a detached reader to conclude that Mark's intention in this story is to describe a historical fact for an audience that is non-Judean, non-Israelite, that are Gentiles. And that combination is the source of then this interpretation of this story, with all the consequences that have flowed. It is on the one hand, fascinating. It is on the one hand, on the other hand, it's terrible. So what happens then in this story is that the invitation to hope that Pilate would release Jesus is disappointed. And he reverts, just as Herod does, to form, and in capitulation to political pressure and to his own reputation, he releases Barabbas and condemns a one who he recognizes as innocent of any crime. He condemns him. So, what is in the background of this story is Mark invites his listeners to think about and reflect on what we now, after Walter Wink's provocative and clarifying research, what we would call the myth of redemptive violence. To name that myth, which we see all the time, it is the myth that the way that human beings will be saved from the powers of evil is that great warriors will arise who will fight and kill evil people, the powers of evil. And that by that act of redemptive violence, that the human community will be free by it. It addresses major traditions, again, the traditions of Israel. There are many examples of the myth of redemptive violence in the traditions of Israel and in the expectations and hopes of the anointed ones of Israel, who are anointed. But classically, it's David as the primary representative of the one who saves Israel by organizing and carrying out systematic warfare against Israel's enemies and establishing the kingdom of David. But this myth is the dominant myth of the ancient world. The most popular story in antiquity was Homer's Iliad. Those who went to school to learn Greek primarily were required to learn Greek by memorizing the Iliad. Plato quotes the Iliad by heart. Everyone learned to recite the Iliad. And I thought that I might give you a little taste of that. And then I also have a film clip of a modern movie, Troy. Just to give you a feeling for Homer's Iliad, let me perform, not perform, this isn't Greek, this is a translation, but you can get a feel for then how the myth of redemptive violence was and became the most popular story in the future. And I'll read you a little bit what leads up to this, which is also about the involvement of Athena, the goddess, and of Phoebus, who is a Diphobos, is a primary character who encourages Hector, as you hear, to finally enter into battle with Achilles, and promises him that she will defend him, but then tricks him. So just notice that as you listen. The goddess, gray-eyed Athena, came now to Pelion and stood close beside him and addressed him in winged words. Beloved of Zeus, shining Achilles, I'm hopeful now that you and I will take back great glory to the ships of the Achaeans after we have killed Hector for all his slakeless fury for battle. Now there is no way for him to get away from us. Not though Apollo, who strikes from afar, should be willing to undergo much and wallow before our father Zeus of the Aegis. Stand you then here and get your wind again, while I go to this man and persuade him to stand up to you in combat. So spoke Athena, and he was glad at heart and obeyed her and stopped and stood leaning on his bronze barbed ash spear. And you'll see that in the movie. Meanwhile, Athena left him there and caught up with brilliant Hector, and likened herself in form and weariless voice to Deiphobus. She came now and stood close to him and addressed him in winged words. Dear brother, indeed, swift-footed Achilles is using you roughly, chasing you on swift feet around the city of Priam. In the earlier story that precedes this, Hector runs away from Achilles three times around the city of Troy. And they're both worn out from chasing each other. Come on, then. Let us stand fast against him and beat him back. Then tall Hector of the shining helm answered, Lephalos, before now you were dearest to me by far of my brothers. Of all those who were sons of Priam and Hecabe, and now I am minded all the more within my heart to honor you, you who dared for my sake, when your eyes saw me, to come forth from the fortifications, while the others stand fast inside them. Then he turned the goddess, Grey Eyed Athena, answered, my brother, it is true our father and the lady our mother, taking my ease in turn, and my companions about me, entreated that I stay with them. Such was the terror upon all of them. The heart within me was worn away by hard sorrow for you. But now let us go straight on and fight hard, that there be no sparing of our spears, so that we can find out whether Achilles will kill us both and carry our bloody war spoils back to the hollow ships, or himself go down under your spear. So Athena spoke, and led him on by beguile. Now, as the two in their advance were come close together, first of the two to speak was tall, helm-glittering Hector. Son of Peleus, I will no longer run from you, as before I fled three times around the great city of Priam, and dared not stand to your onslaught. But now my spirit in turn has driven me to stand and face you. I must take you now, or I must be taken. Come then. Shall we swear before the gods, for these are the highest who shall be witnesses and watch over our agreements. Brutal as you are, I will not defy you, if Zeus grants to me that I can wear you out and take the life from you. But after I have stripped your glorious armor, Achilles, I will give your corpse back to the Achaeans. Do you do likewise? Then looking darkly at him, swift-footed Achilles answered, Hector, argue me no agreements. I cannot forgive you, as there are no trustworthy oaths between men and lions, nor wolves and lambs have spirits that can be brought to agreement, but forever these hold feelings of hate for each other. So there can be no love between you and me, nor shall there be oaths between us. But one or the other must fall before them to glut with his blood Ares, the god who fights under the shield's guard. Remember every valor of yours, for now the need comes hardest upon you to be a spearman and a bold warrior. There shall be no more escape for you. If Pallas Athena will kill you soon by my spear, you will pay in a lump for all those sorrows of my companion who killed in your spear's fury. So he spoke. And balanced the spear far shadow and threw it. The glorious Hector kept his eyes on him and avoided it, for he dropped, watchful to his knee, and the bronze spear flew over his shoulder and stuck in the ground. But Pallas Athena snatched it and gave it back to Achilles, unseen by Hector, shepherd of the people. But now Hector spoke out to the blameless son of Achilles. You missed! And it was not, O Achilles, like the immortals, from Zeus that you knew my destiny, but you thought so, or rather you are someone clever in speech and spoke to swindle me, to make me afraid of you and forget my valor and war strength. You will not stick your spear in my back as I run away from you, but drive it into my chest as I storm straight in against you, if the god gives you that. And now look for my brazen spear. I wish it might be taken full length in your body. And indeed, the war would be a lighter thing for the Trojans if you were dead, seeing that you are their greatest afflictions. So he spoke, balanced the spear far shadowed and threw it, and struck the middle, Goliath's shield, nor missed it. But the spear was driven far back from the shield. And Hector was angered because his swift weapon had been loosed from his hand in a vain cast. He stood discouraged and had no other ash spear. Lifting his voice, he called aloud from Deiphobus of the pale shield and asked him for a long spear. The Deiphobus was not near him. Hector knew the truth inside his heart and spoke aloud. No use. Here at last the gods have summoned him again. I thought Deiphobus, the hero, was there close beside me, but he is behind the wall, and it was Athena cheating. And now evil death is close to me, and no longer far away. There is no way out. So it must long since have been pleasing to Zeus, and Zeus's son, who strikes from afar this way. But before this they defended me dead. And now my death is at home. Let me at least not die without a struggle in glorious. But do some big thing first, that men to come shall know. So he spoke. Pulling out the sharp sword that was slung at the hollow of his side, huge and heavy, and gathering himself together, he made a swoop. Like a high-flown eagle who launches himself out of the murk of the clouds on the flat land, catch away a tender lamb or a shivering hare. So Hector made his swoop, swinging his sharp sword. And Achilles charged, the heart within him loaded with savage fury. In front of his chest, the beautiful, elaborate great shield covered him. And with a glittering helm with four horns, he nodded. The lovely golden fringes were shaken about it, which Hephaestus had driven close along the horn of the helmet. And as the star moves among stars in the night's darkening, Hesper, who is the fairest star who stands in the sky, such was the shining from the pointed spear Achilles was shaking in his right hand with evil intention toward brilliant Hector. He was eyeing Hector's splendid body to see where it might best give way. But all the rest of the skin was held in the armor, brazen and splendid. He stripped when he cut down the strength of Patroclus, who Hector close it, killed the day before. It was Achilles' closest friend. But yet it showed where the collarbones hold the neck from the shoulders, the throat, where death of the soul comes most swiftly. In this place, brilliant Achilles drove the spear as he came on in fury, and clean through the soft part of the neck, the spear point was driven. Yet the ash spear, heavy with bronze, did not sever the windpipe, so that Hector could still make exchange in words spoken. But he dropped in the dust, and brilliant Achilles wandered above him. Hector, surely you thought as you killed Patroclus, you would be saved. Since I was far away, you thought nothing of me, oh fool, for an avenger was left far greater than you was, behind him and away by the hollow shells, and it was I. And I have broken the strength, and you, the dogs and the vultures, shall feed and foul and rip. The Achaeans will bury Patroclus. In his weakness, Hector of the shining mouth spoke to me. I treat you by your life, by your knees, by your parents. Do not let the dogs feed on you by the ships of the Achaeans. But take yourself the bronze and gold that are there in abundance, those gifts that my father and the lady, my mother, will give you, and give my body to be taken home again. So that the Trojans and the wives of the Trojans may give me the death of my life and burn. But looking dark at him, the swift fury Achilles answered, no more entreating of me, you dog, by means of parents. I wish only that my spirit and fury would drive me to Hector and meet away and be involved with the things that you have done to me. So there is no one who can hold the dogs off from your head. Not if they bring here and set before me 10 times and 20 times the ransom, and promise more in addition. Not a Priam, son of Dardanus, should offer to weigh out your bulk in gold. Not even so shall the lady, your mother, who herself bore you, lay you on the deathbed in the morning. No. The dogs and the birds will have you for all their feasting. Then dying, Hector of the Shining Helmet spoke. I know you well, as I look upon you. I know that I could not persuade you, since in you your breast is a part of life. Be careful now, for I might be made into God's curse upon you, on that day in Paris, and Phoebus Apollo destroy you in the sky and gates, for all your value. He spoke, as he spoke, the end of death closed in upon him, and the soul fluttering free of the limbs went down into death's house, mourning her destiny, leaving youth and manhood behind. Now he was a dead man. Though he was a dead man, brilliant, Achilles spoke to him, die. I will take my own death at whatever time Zeus and the rest of the immortals choose to accomplish. He spoke and pulled the brazen spear from the body and laid it on one side and stripped away from the shoulders his bloody arm. The other sons of the Achaeans came running about him, gazed upon the stature and on the imposing beauty of Hector, and none stood beside him who did not stab him. Thus they would speak to him, each looking at his name. See now, Hector is much softer to handle than he was when he set the ships ablaze with the burning firebrand. So as they stood beside him, they would speak to stuff. This was the story more widely told than any story in ancient world. Men would stay up all night and recite the Iliad. And this was the climax of the first climax. What follows in the ensuing books is the description of the grief of Priam, Hector's father, who went in anxious and begged Achilles for Hector's body. And after, I think, a day, a few days, Achilles finally agreed and had pity on the father and gave him Hector's body. He took him back after his burn. So this story is a paradigmatic story that is now replayed over and over in modern movies. And so I thought I'd show you first the battle scene from Troy, which is this story, and then from the movie Avatar, the climax battle between the commander of the forces attacking the planet and the people of Avatar, who's in I don't know what you call it. It's a military. Well, he's like one of these Iron Men in the movies. So it is again the climactic battle, but there are two of them. There's an Avatar. So let me show you these.
Draw no paths between the lines and you. Now you know who you're fighting. I pointed with you out fighting yesterday. And I wish it had been. But I gave the dead boy the honor he deserved. I've
given him the honor he deserved. And what have I said? Won't have ears or a tongue. You will wander the underworld blind, deaf and dumb, and all the dead you know. This is Hector, the fool who thought he killed the kings. What a fool.
This is a series of clips Sheer numbers. Then the top 100 films domestic gross adjusted for inflation. So Avatar is the all-time best seller, both domestic and worldwide. But Gone with the Wind is in terms of adjusted for inflation. The domestic gross all-time bestseller. But what I'd like for you to look at is the top 100 films of all time on the right. And these are all instances of the make of redemptive violence. Avatar is not checked, but it should be. Marvel's The Avengers, The Furious Seven, Iron Man 3, Transformers, The Lord of the Rings, Transformers Age of Extinction, The Dark Knight Rises.
I mean, ones that are checked early.
Yes, but I also, I know now there are some that are not checked that are also. So those are just examples of the way in which these stories of the myth of redemptive violence have been the most popular stories in human history, both ancient and modern. So I just thought that, you know, I just looked that up, I just wondered. And another thing to notice about this list is how many of them are recent movies. So Avatar is 2009. The Avengers of 2012, The Furious Seven, which was the all-time, that was the big seller this year, in 2015, by far more than any other movie this year. Iron Man 2013, Transformers 2011, Transformers 2014. So it's within the last 7-8 years that the top films that are instances of replays of the myth of redemptive violence have been popular. One of the reasons for that, I saw an interview with the producer who said the film industry has radically changed. You cannot produce the kinds of movies that used to be possible. Because what's driving it now is the worldwide market outside the United States. And that these films of redemptive violence are wildly popular in Asia, in Latin America, in Africa, in Europe, in Russia is one of the big places where these movies sell. So what this indicates is, in terms of, I don't know, the rhetoric of implications, this myth is alive and well, and is, in terms of contemporary storytelling, the overwhelming mythological framework that is being marketed with enormous profits for these movies. And so producers are actively looking for new ways to package this old story. Now, one of the things that is striking about the ancient world is that when there was real competition between stories, that in the aftermath of the fall of the Roman Empire, what became the dominant story in Western civilization was not the story of Achilles, nor was it the story of Aeneas, but it was the story of Jesus. Now, albeit there were perversions in the interpretation of that story and so on, but it prevailed in the ancient competition between the stories and became the most popular story of the ancient world. So that the story that emerged from the ancient world as the most widespread belief story was the Jesus story, the stories of the Gospels, not the Iliad and the of the Anew, which were the signature national stories for the nation states of Greece, Rome, the empires of the ancient world. So, one of the reasons why I am bold about encouraging and sponsoring that you would form a storytelling network who would tell the stories of Jesus is that it's a very powerful story. And especially in the context of people who are war weird and are looking for some way other than the redemptive violence. There are enormously powerful forces driving that way. People make piles and piles of money off the redemptive violence. But it has such enormous consequences. People live out that story as young men are regularly seduced in doing because it's the story with which they have identified in a variety of ways.
I may feel mystic for the reconnect with the divine idea to the pilot one.
Yes. I think that, no, I think that's what, maybe I didn't say it clearly. But,
yeah.
My perception, my analysis, my exegesis, would have understood was the choice of the audience, was the reason for the choice of the audience, was that they chose the war. And that it reflected then the decision that the nation had made in regard to the revolt against Rome and in relation to the basic belief system was the primary legacy of the religion of Israel.
So, point just one point. What was the choice? They chose Barabbas.
Who represented the way of war and the myth of redemptive violence.
Over against
Jesus.
Who represented
the myth of redemption through love of the end. So, in the story, there is an experience for the listener of this choice.
So, why doesn't Mark tell the story in the plural, we? Why does he say we chose? We made this choice.
No need to say.
Maybe a need now.
Because the audience assumed that. It is a story that is a story by Judeans, for Judeans, and so there was no need to identify we. We is implied in every part of this one.
What would you have expected the we in the rhetoric?
Well, in the fashion in which Tom has told the story, the surprise, you know, how could we have freed Barabbas and sent Jesus to the cross? That's what we did. As you're saying, that would have been obvious at that time to someone hearing the story that I'm implicated in that choice.
Yeah.
So it's part of my experience of the story today then is to say that someone has been successful in transforming that story so that I no longer feel implicated in the choice.
That's right.
That's right. The other similar question that I wonder how much difference 2,000 years makes is that some of sociology, anthropology would be that there wasn't a uniform Jewish community that there were various sects. I mean, the insurrectors, the cynics, and the what were they called? The assassins and others. That there were
Sicarii.
Yeah, were present, also providing choices as to who to follow.
Yeah.
In that.
Right. So there was a in the post-war period, there was a rhetorical, a religious, organizational battle between the parts of the big tent of the religion of Israel prior to the war. The big tent had Pharisees, Sadducees, Essenes, revolutionary zealots in the tradition of the Maccabees, and so all of those were present. In the aftermath of the war, the priests had disappeared. The temple was no more. The priests literally vanished from history and were associated with the war. In the popular understanding of what happened, the Pharisees were successful in surviving the war. And they became the architects of rabbinic Judaism.
But the Sadducees.
Sadducees were associated with the priests. They were friends of the priests.
They were gone.
They were gone. Sadducees disappeared. They were missing. Pharisees continued, and the followers of Jesus continued, and the forces that were aligned with the belief in the need for an independent Israel and for war against the Romans also survived, as is clear from the Bar Kokhba revolt in 130-132. In which they succeeded for a year of driving the Romans out of Palestine. This time when they came back, they left nothing. They destroyed the entire city of Jerusalem. They salted it and then built a new city around its ruins called the Roman capital. So they built a Roman city and populated it with Romans.
And that's some of the heavy stones.
And the Western Wall, which is
right.
You know, I thought another thing that was of interest, and I just saw this, I thought I'd just pass this out. In terms of this connection between religion and politics now, in Israel, this is an article from the Christian Science Monitor 2 days ago, about the sharp increase in Orthodox Jews serving as officers in the Israeli army.
Yes.
So more than 30%, well, more than 25% now of the officers in the Israeli army are graduates of a new school that was established in 2009 to teach Orthodox Jews the military traditions of Israel and to increase them, their religious identity. Prior to this, the army had been largely secular. And so there was a great concern among secular Israelis about the growing dominance of religious Jews in the army. They are uniformly, according to the article, favor of driving out Palestine, taking over all the land, and continuing the war more aggressively in the military traditions.
So in terms of the continuity of the story over 2,000 years, where do those Palestinian Christians in that part of the world today appear, or what do they represent in terms of that lineage? Versus what you or I represent in terms of that narrative and image.
And it goes back to the question I asked offline yesterday, is what is the story from the gospel that we would tell to Palestinian Christians today in terms of peacemaking, social justice?
Well, the easy and most immediate answer is I don't know. And so the most honest thing that I could say is that's a question. It's a really good question that is raised by the story. And the impact of its retelling, which happens all the time. So another dimension of the battle over the interpretation of religious tradition is this. What it would generate, I don't know. And to think about it, I'd be glad to think about it, and I would invite everybody to think about it, including the Palestinian Christian. The first thing that occurs to me is that the apparent absurdity of Jesus doing good for his enemies and the degree to which that defines the character of his messiahship and of that and of the gospel in regard to that would be something that I propose to think about.
And in the context of the Senate Library, the Bible and Social Justice is the host for this conversation now, and we hope moving forward is that our first anthology was liberating Bible study. And one of the, at least, implicit, I mean, explicit, is that the relevance of liberation theology as being at the root here. And so one of the places we would look in terms of the conversation with our Palestinian brothers and sisters are those who are engaged to Nabil Atik and others in the Palestinian liberation theology, the Black liberation theology, the Latin American liberation theology. But what is the way in which liberation theology represents a use of the tool of storytelling as a way of pursuing social justice? Because it does. We have posters all through here that speak to that too.
And I would think also because
maybe tomorrow morning discussion.
Those are all good questions. One of the things that I observe about liberation theology is that its primary strategies are ideological rather than storytelling. But they are heavily philosophical and theological. Whereas that part of the problem that generates is it's not very popular. Now it is popular. There are dimensions of its popularity, but it is not the kind of storytelling mass tradition that gets generated by a storytelling network of people who learn and tell these stories as a part of their worship life, part of their and another dimension of that is that these stories have the unique capacity to shape the social memory of communities in a way that an ideology does not. And not a critique of the ideology. That's not what I'm expressing. I'm just identifying what emerges from the study of the canonical tradition and of its power over the centuries, including its power in the first century, to generate new communities, new approaches, new understandings of God that are part of what has been called the revelation of God in the New Testament. And there's a consistency of theme also in this, in the Synoptic Testament. And Paul and Acts, as Acts is about the extension of good deeds on the part of Judeans to Gentiles. And that systematic outreach, which led to polls there, because of the fury that that generated among other Judeans. But Paul's letters and the formation of these communities that were characteristic of Christianity in the late first century were inspired and energized by the interiorization and the telling of the stories from the Gospels and Acts. So that there's a way in which the New Testament is unified by a consistency of theme in regard to this issue.
I think maybe the media have done a job on this liberation theology in Latin America. We visited some of the base communities when we were in Colombia. The one that sticks in my mind is one next to a Catholic church. It was blocked, like a block party, actually. They looked like one another. But we went to their evening service, and you may have to remember how it, but they read a story from John, Gospel of John. They acted out the story. There were some hymns. There was some time for the people to comment on what they heard or something. And even included like some pastoral counseling. You know, some woman said, you know, I'm grieving all the time with my dead husband, and I'm wondering if I contributed enough at his funeral. And the priest said, it has nothing to do with the contribution at the funeral. He said, your husband must have impressed you a great deal. He must have had a powerful positive contribution to your life, and it's appropriate that he should appear. Did I get it?
More or less,
right? Yeah. And I'm thinking of the gospel that's so on to now, when you read those, the stories pop up a lot in themselves. You know, and perhaps the thing that astonished me most, since everywhere we were well, with the theology of dead, was when I was invited to the organizing committee or event, maybe the second time, of a Congress of Biblical Scholars in Latin America, in Brazil this was, and I was invited to speak. And it struck me, because I perceived when it wasn't meant, that liberation theology was the foundation, was given by all of the presenters, and these were academics. Yeah. So it is alive, and well, but, and the Pope
yeah.
is giving it a little yeah. more infusion.
Yeah.
So, I always sort of understood it as really empowering people, grassroots people, to tell their stories.
Yeah.
And they're, as well, the different,
yeah.
bringing up a different perspective.
Yeah, I think it goes together. I mean, look how small we are. We're like a little base community and we're telling stories. Mm-hmm. Probably that's the way some people could be encouraged to tell a story,
right?
Rather than them stand before 50 or 100 people.
Right.
I mean, you did your first one with a small one, small congregation.
30.
That's not huge enough. But you're very good. You're good. You're good. Pick the ground or not, once you get up there, woo.
Right.
So should we?
But I would observe that what we found with the network is that there are a lot of people who are really good. They just don't know it.
Yeah.
They discover in learning these stories
yes.
a dimension of their own identity and of their own gift that they didn't know that they had. And so it has been profoundly transformative for a whole series of individuals where learning and telling these stories has been it's changed their lives. It's mm-hmm. changed their self-concept. And so my projection is that that would also be the case if there was a storytelling, biblical storytelling network that was developed in Latin America. Now, there are ways in which that's already happened. The Gospel of Solomon is a good example of that. Yeah. But it hasn't been been more improvisational. There has not been the degree of the formation of social memory
that happens when people learn basically the same story and tell it to each other in ways that then forms a common number of stories. So there is a unique community formation dimension to the learning of the same story by a network of people. And it operates in a very different way than the hierarchical systems of education, of higher learning. Part of my dream, I guess, is that there could be a combination of scholarly study of these materials at its highest level as performance literature, as story, that could inform and provide resources for a broad-based, full storytelling tradition that could be generated out of that if the role of the Gospels, the role of the Scriptures, was reconceived as the empowerment of the storytelling community rather than as a source of theological and historical data for interpretation in theological or historical categories. It's a very different frame that in turn generates a new range of possibilities.
And that's the barrier that says to break through, both for us, Center and Library, and those who are connected there, and the Storytelling Network.
So this is effectively a segue, an introduction to our final session tomorrow on Biblical Performance Criticism, a New Paradigm for Biblical Interpretation.
Right.
So we've introduced ourselves and our audience to that topic, and we'll bring it back to a public conversation tomorrow at 10:15.
And another dimension of that I would name is we're going to explore how personally and communally, corporately, when we think about the model of doing good for your enemies as a policy.
And are we going to use the resurrection story as a part of that analysis tomorrow?
Yeah.
You know, when you put it that way, I've been starting to think about trying to list everybody who's an enemy or an outsider. And the simple point where I began was the homeless people in People's Park, our church in Brooklyn, right across from them. And we had one of the street chaplains who deals with homeless. He says, the first thing about it all is to get eye contact. If they want to be noticed, hundreds of people are passing by and not looked at them. So make eye contact and offer to talk.
Right.
And sometimes they will and sometimes they won't. Right. And it's changed. It changed not only what I do, but my attitude. You know, they're not all the same. Good morning.